Hello everyone, my name is Dr. Christina Cavillo Santos. Welcome back to my channel. And if you're new here, please click like and subscribe. Today's guest is Chelsea. Chelsea is a naturopathic doctor. She's also an intuitive healer. And I have the honor of having her as my guest today. We met about a year or so ago while we were both in a mentorship together, studying business of functional medicine. And not knowing how much we have in common, I naturally gravitated towards her and asked her to be my accountability partner. And throughout the past year, I've learned so much about her and how much we have in common. So I'm really, really happy, Chelsea, that you're here with me today. And you're joining us from Canada.
Yes, thank you for having me. I'm so honored. And as each day passes, we find more and more things we have in common. So that's just a fun continuing story. And I have to make a note, a legal disclaimer. I'm no longer a naturopathic doctor. Okay. I resigned my license. So in case the Ontario board says anything, I am not a naturopathic doctor anymore.
You still have that knowledge, however, in your tool belt. So all the years of studying and knowledge that comes from that is not to be thrown out the window. License or no license anymore, you're a wealth of knowledge to the people that you work with. So I'm really, really happy to share that with my audience today. And on that note, the main topic for today will be emotional and spiritual health and how it affects the physical body. And so I really want you to talk from your experience. It can be your personal experience, of course, but also when working with clients and what you've discovered, whether from naturopathic angle or other modalities that you've studied and worked with. So on that note, tell me a little bit about your background. How did you step into the role as a healer and even wanting to address, you know, emotional and spiritual health to heal the physical body, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I kind of sort of fell into it. I mean, I had issues ever since I was a kid, like from a really young age, like born basically, I had issues. But it wasn't until I got into my early teens that a family member of mine who did kind of like some alternative methods with a practitioner kind of put the seed in my mom's ear, like maybe there's something going on that this mm-hmm. person could help her with. So I was introduced to this medical doctor who was practicing more like a naturopathic doctor. And at that time, he was not licensed as a medical doctor, and he was doing something called electrodermal screening. So it's like using acupressure points, right? Mm-hmm. Along certain acupressure points, you're checking the resistance of the skin or the electrical potential of the skin, and then testing things energetically against that to see if there's a weakness there or a strength in the skin. There's like an electrical charge that changes, right? Mm-hmm. So through that kind of work, that's where I really started getting more insight into like, okay, there's something more than meets the eye here for health. Even things like nutritional deficiencies, they would assess through that machine, and I would be supplementing and I would feel so much better. So I could see, you know, the cause and effect happening. And then it went even deeper than that into more energetic, you know, work with flower essences or different emotions. And then it really came full circle when I went to naturopathic college. I thought I would be doing that, basically that kind of work. Yeah. And then I realized very quickly that that was not at all what was kind of accepted in the naturopathic field.
Right.
So I kind of put my head down, did all my studies, did all the, you know, the scientific background, functional lab type style assessments, which is also great. But I really, that my heart was really in the energetics of things, mm-hmm. just from my own experience of getting better with it. So it's really when I graduated, I ended up working with that same practitioner. And that's where I could kind of research and figure out all the different like emotions and different energetic influences that helped the physical shift.
That's amazing. Yeah. And I mean, when we look at the, obviously me as a Chinese medical practitioner, we look at the organ function and how each of the organs is attributed in motion. So for instance, you know, I know a lot of people have heard about liver and how anger is one of the emotions that can be quite exacerbated when something energetically is off within the liver organ. So we don't look at it quite the same as Western medicine. So when we say, oh, wow, liver anger, what does that mean, right? But there's definitely energetic imbalances within that organ space that can cause specific emotions to just rage, right? Mm-hmm. And so is that something similar that you've been kind of working with as well, or does it differ in some way?
Yeah, so in the naturopathic training that I did in Canada, we have some Chinese medicine woven in. Okay. So I had some of that knowledge. I love the Chinese medicine organ clock and like the different energetic, emotional, you know, pieces to that. Right. So I had that kind of thinking already. And when I did the electrodermal screening, it gave me the opportunity to kind of test out those theories. And I found that was often the case. There could be an emotion that was resonating and there was a certain organ, or more commonly it was testing the organs energetically, yeah, seeing them, their imbalances, mm-hmm, figuring out if there's a physical or maybe an emotional imbalance. And if there's an emotional imbalance, that's where I'd use my skills to think, okay, you know, what emotions could that be? And then even things, you know, I wasn't as adept at the Chinese herbs. So even things like a flower essence, which is basically like the energy of a specific flower, that can shift the emotional state, which then shifts the organ assessment energetically. So yeah, all of that information works really well together. And the other interesting piece that I found was I did a lot of testing for like microbes, so bacteria, viruses, fungi, that kind of thing. And I'd see some people repeatedly have the same things over and over that came up. And, you know, I had different machines that would energetically kind of cancel those things out so they wouldn't test as an issue anymore. But then the next time they might come back and it was there again. Mm. So I started thinking, okay, there must be something going on here that creates this pattern of this specific, let's say it's a bacteria, the specific bacteria that keeps coming up each time. So I would actually get the opportunity to almost ask the body, what's going on with this bacteria? Why are you still resonating with it? Mm. And at times it would be an emotion. So like guilt and shame were often tied with bacteria. Mm. I just started noticing patterns, right, in all my years. So I started recognizing that if you've got those emotions and they're sitting somewhere in the body, it's creating a specific resonance, a specific frequency. And then this specific bacteria can have that same frequency, and it's gonna stay around if it's got a frequency it likes, right? The analogy I like to give is like, if you've got a garbage pile, there's gonna be flies attracted to that. So you can't get rid of the flies if you still have the garbage pile. So same idea, if there was these stuck emotions in the body, you know, how can you shift anything else really? So.
Yeah, I see that with my clients who, I'm going to give an example of physical pain and like muscle tension, especially in people who constantly ruminate, worry, you know, even before sleep, they just can't shut themselves off. And there's just constant tension, no matter how many like cupping treatments, massage, you know, acupuncture. It's just, we really have to address the emotional awareness in that particular person. So they're like, well, why is this not going away? Why is this, what's going on? Everything is fine. Do you worry? Of course I worry. I worry all the time, right? And so it just becomes a norm for people to stay in those patterns of overthinking and just worrying about everything, every little thing in their life. I actually had a client who's 81 years old, and she worries about her granddaughter, who is a police officer. And so she's constantly worrying about her. And she's like, oh, this back pain is killing me. It's killing me. It's not going away. Now we're at 10th treatment, and she's still worrying about her granddaughter, you know? And the funny thing I'm going to mention is that her granddaughter gets into an accident at work. And she is so happy about that because she was sending out that energy vibration out into the world. Oh my God, I hope something happens to her so she can't do that job anymore. And I was like, oh my God, do you realize what you're doing? You know, I'm not saying that you directly cause her to get injured, but just that energetic vibration and then being in the vicinity of her granddaughter and her granddaughter knowing that she works in a specific area of the city here in Brooklyn, you know, where it's not like the most calm place to be. And now she can't do her job. So it's very, very interesting to see these patterns in clients and patients when they're not even aware of them, right? And then,
yeah,
you know, that's like in Chinese medicine, the worry is attributed to the earth element and the spleen governs the muscles and the digestive system. So there's a lot of gut health issues and it's just like, wow, everything is really connected. So to hear you talk about it from your perspective is really, really amazing. So can you tell me a little bit about that stuff, bacteria, viruses? Are you still using the skin machine testing, or are you using muscle testing, or are you just using your intuition? How are you approaching it?
Yeah, so the electrodermal screening was kind of how I figured things out. I researched, I put two and two together, I recognized patterns. And then I did work with dark field microscopy for a while. So actually looking at the blood under a microscope and seeing that. And that actually also validated visually for me some of the things that I discovered when I did the electrodermal screening. So again, it gave me a really good background to kind of play around with the energy and see mm-hmm. what was really going on. Mm-hmm. And then as I progressed over the years, I went away from the electrodermal screening mm-hmm. and I did what's called dowsing. So you use a pendulum and then I did muscle testing as well. But I find now I don't really use any of those tools because I just get the intuitive messages or inkling in the body. I can feel what a yes or a no is, so to speak. Mm-hmm. So my intuition works basically with me asking questions, you know, is there a physical issue? Yes, no. Is there an emotional issue? Yes, no. And then just going down basically a list. I have a whole scan, a spreadsheet scan that I laid out. So I kind mm-hmm. of do that as my overall scan for people. Mm-hmm. So yeah, my skills kind of developed over that time, but it for sure came from the playing around with the energy and getting that feedback from something that was kind of removed from me that I could sort of more objectively assess.
Yeah.
So
what are some of the tools that you use for yourself to deepen your intuition? And, you know, I talk a lot about that when I work with clients one-on-one, but just for the general public, what are some ways, because I feel like we're so oversaturated with information on a daily basis that it's hard to just be present within yourself, let alone with the people that, you know, you cohabitate the same space. So what are some things that you do for yourself to be present and be able to know that that is actually your intuition and not just your, you know, sympathetic nervous system bombarding you with information?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's so many avenues we can go into with that. And that's what I do one-on-one too, is like it's what I call the best long-term health strategy. If you know what is good for you, then that's golden, right? So I really try and get people to that point with practicing this. And it kind of depends on the person. So for some people, it is starting out making a list. You know, if you have a big decision, for example, you make a list of, okay, what would it look like if I made that decision? Pros and cons kind of a thing. Mm-hmm. So you can do similar things to practice with your intuition, like making a list of, okay, if I did this thing, what's the logical list? And then go into the feeling of it. How would I feel? Mm-hmm. Can you envision, okay, if I made that decision, how does my body feel? So just mm-hmm. giving a moment to drop into the body And I love what you said about the information overload, right? Because there is so much bombarding us, but it really, the key is taking just some moments to yourself to tune in. And I have a specific meditation in my signature program, my 6-month program, that actually helps people get into their body and start connecting with the symptoms that they have to get the messages themselves spontaneously. So you can do, you know, guided meditations like that as well. But it's really just, it's practice. It's practicing. Like when I first started, it was just practicing what a yes felt like, what a no felt like. So those are some of the strategies for that, but really just playing with it, because inevitably there will be a time where you think, oh, that was a yes, but, you know, obviously must not have been because it doesn't feel good. Like there's a period where you're trying to discern between the feeling and the logical mind. And that's just a matter of practice, but really it comes down to learning how your heart speaks versus learning how your mind speaks. And your mind tends to be the more like aggressive, judgmental, snappy, you know, more force behind it, where the heart is more like a whisper, a gentle, it's very subtle. And again, your intuition can work with asking for messages. In the waking world, it can be dreams. There's so many different avenues. And it really depends on the person.
Yeah, I love that. I mean, I talk about mindfulness a lot as a starting point, because when I talk about meditation, people usually associate it with sitting still, clearing their mind completely of their thoughts. And that is a very difficult thing, especially for beginners when trying to meditate. So it's like, it's a process of trying and not really doing it. So I say, how about you try to be focused on one thing at a time, because again, we're so used to multitasking. And I usually say, okay, pick one thing that you do every day in your everyday life, whether it's brushing your teeth or doing your dishes or making your bed, and just be fully present, right? Try to focus on every aspect of you doing that one single action. And through practice, because it's a process, like you said, it's practice. I feel like a lot of people expect miraculous results fast. Now, we're in the world of now. I have gut issues. I want them gone now. I want my meditation practice to be awesome now. So we're so focused on the results and we forget that it's a process. It's a journey, and it can take a while, right? In your experience, obviously it is person to person, but what can you say to how long usually it takes for people to see real change and stay with that change within their body, right? Not like, oh, I feel better today, but then it returns the next week or the next month or 5 months later. So it's a process. And in your experience, what can you tell the audience about the process and how long it usually lasts?
Yeah, it really is so individual. It depends on, I'd say, a few factors. So it's readiness to change. So, you know, are you really willing to make the changes that create the change? Or do you want the change without changing? That's really one of the really big pieces. So some people think that they're ready, but they're really not. So in that case, it's going to take much longer than someone who says, okay, I'm ready for this, let's do it. It could be a number of days before people see changes. I just had, you know, a client today say, hey, it's been 3 days and everything's gone. Great. They were at a level of readiness where they were willing to implement the action steps. So I really think it's that readiness, first of all, and commitment to what your goal is on the other side. You know, how I guess that's the readiness again. Like, how willing are you to do this at all costs so that you can get that result you're looking for, and then maintain it. So the maintenance from the physical perspective, that's where things really vary, because it could be, you know, a nutritional element or a supplementational element or, you know, whatever, but it's really what makes the long lasting changes is that that willingness, the readiness, the emotional piece that's got to be, you know, at the precipice of change, at least, to really make fast and lasting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I find that the same in my practice. It's the people who are really ready and do the work are people who see the results the fastest, and then those results also last longer, right? Of mm-hmm. course, living life, we get caught up, you know, things come up and people do need to come for tune-ups and address other aspects of themselves because we are such a complex human being, right? But when people are not ready to change and, you know, they just want to absorb information without doing any work, it doesn't happen. That's my experience for sure.
Yeah, because you mentioned this, that the people who are ready, but in terms of long-term change, those people have the consciousness now available to them to recognize when things are starting to veer off course, mm-hmm. so that they can center themselves or get those tune-ups or, you know, do what shifts they need to do. And, you know, you and I provide them with that information to kind of prep them for that as well. But that's where it's just so much easier to keep on track and maintain results when you've already had that level of readiness to begin with.
Exactly. Then they have more awareness to feel, like what you were saying earlier, within their body. It's like, oh, something feels off here. What mm-hmm. is happening really inside, right? And yeah. I love when I get feedback from my clients. They're like, oh, you know, I had this happen, but I knew exactly what it was. So they didn't even need to reach out. And so it's great that we're not, you know, attaching our clients to ourselves, right? But we are giving them the tools so they can continue to be their own healers, you know, for the rest of their lives, ultimately is the key, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, what is something that you specialize in? If you do, is there some area that you really like working with clients, be it, you know, gut health, like we mentioned already, or anything else, or like really the spiritual aspect of the being? What is something that you kind of like, okay, this is my niche. This is what I really am passionate about doing. And how do you share your gifts?
Yeah. So I have three programs, and all three of them, I kind of have this approach using my background of naturopathic medicine, but also a lot, environmental medicine and the energetics. So in the energetics and environmental medicine, I came across the pattern of a lot of toxicity, and that could be emotional toxicity or physical toxins. So heavy metals, chemicals as well. I often find if there's a block in the body, there's something intertwined with the energetics and the physical toxin. So most of my work is really based around kind of personalized detoxes at the core of it. And I love working with people on the intuitive. So sometimes it depends on where someone's at. Sometimes I'm taking someone who is just starting to recognize that they sense, you know, emotions from others, or that they feel things in their body. And at other times I'm working with people who already know that their intuition is speaking to them, but they don't know how to link that together and how to get the results on the physical. Mm. Sometimes my intuitive messages are like what seem like past lives information, or, you know, other spiritual content like that. So I really tailor it so much to where someone's at, because the information that I'm getting when I go into my intuitive space is whatever they're presenting like in their field. So that can vary, you know, from person to person for sure.
Yeah, I love that. I mean, I love working with emotions in the spiritual realm as well, especially, you know, some of the beliefs we have in Chinese medicine is that we even choose the parents for ourselves to experience a specific aspect of ourselves in this lifetime to get better, for our soul to grow. And so even, you know, even certain diseases and illnesses that some of us are born with or accumulate throughout life, it's all to bring us back to the connection with ourselves. And so really addressing those aspects of a person is something that I really really resonate with. So I'm glad that you mentioned that as well. So tell me, where can people find you in the online space? Obviously, you're in Canada, but I know that you're also on social media, and I've had the pleasure of referring a client to you and they really had a breakthrough. So I think it's very useful that as practitioners, we all stay connected and know what our strengths are and what our weaknesses are, so we can really share and guide our clients and really give them the best possible resources for healing.
Mm-hmm. So online, joyfulbodymethod.com, and Instagram is joyfulbodymethod. And on both my website and Instagram, there's my three programs there that are listed. I have two that are functional medicine, and then a third program, which is solely clinical experience and intuitive. So I add the intuitive and clinical into all of my programs, but one of them is just solely that. And I have been opening up the opportunity for referrals from fellow practitioners who just want that a different lens or a different viewpoint. And I love helping out in any which way.
Awesome. Chelsea, thank you so much for joining me today and sharing your knowledge. And just, you're really a joy to listen to. I love watching your Instagram videos. You always share amazing information, and keep on doing that, because really the world needs you. So we'll talk to you soon.
Thank you so much.
Have a great day, and I'll see you soon.
Okay. Bye. Thank you. Bye.